ओम विष्णु पदाय कृष्ण प्रस्ताय भूतलाय श्रीमक्ति भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी इति नामने नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी वस्यात्यदय सुधारिणे श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवासिदि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे Hare Rama, Ram, Ram, Hare Hare. So I thank Buddha Bhagavan Prabhu for that very, what we say, it was inspiring, but it was very soul-searching class. It made you think about different aspects of how to improve. Actually, what he spoke about was the heart of bhakti. As soon as we develop or acquiesce the mood of developing humility, everything else follows. I was supposed to give the second verse of Shikshastika prayers as part of this early morning class today, but somehow or other the class ended a little early and the questions took more time than I expected. So I'm supposed to give the third verse, which is Trinadapi Sunichena, Dayoviva Sahishnuna, Amanina Mamanadena Kirtaniya Sadarihi. But I didn't do the second verse, so I'm going to go through the second verse and then actually focus on the third verse. So we mentioned this morning how the seven principles or seven benedictions of the holy name were mentioned in the first verse. Now that's Lord Chaitanya's glorification of the process of Sankirtan, or glorification of the holy name of the Lord. In the second verse, after stating that, he pretty much puts himself in a position of a common conditioned soul. And he says, although the holy name is all glorious, there's no rules, there's no regulations, there's no restrictions, the names of the Lord are as unlimited as the Lord, still, he ends the verse, Dirdaivam idrisami hajini nanuragaha. Dirdaivam, in that verse, let's all chant the verse anyway, just to get a little feel of the verse. Nam Nam Akari Bahudha Nidza Sarva Shaktis Tattar Pitani Harita Smaranena Kalaha Etadu Sri Tapakripa Adaham Mamapi Durdaiva Mitri Samvihajani Nanduragaha. After glorifying the holy name and also giving the, what we say, the lack of qualifications that is required to chant. In other words, anyone can chant. The only qualification is to have a tongue and two ears. In other words, everyone's qualified. Anyone's available for the mercy of the holy name. But after glorifying the holy name, and he says the holy name, there are two types of holy names. There are the prominent names of the Lord and the secondary names of the Lord. He doesn't want us to chant the secondary names. The secondary names of the Lord are the names of the Lord that are the nature of God in his function as the material ingredient. In other words, he's called Parmeshwara, the Supreme Paramatma, or Ishwara, God, Brahman, knows those names that are attributed to the creative aspects of the Lord's part. In other words, the Vishnu aspects. These first names, or what we say the prominent names, are Krishna, Govinda, Gopijana, Vallabha, Gopinath. These names are emphasized as a glorification. And so he emphasizes that. Now, just to get to the main point, this particular verse is an Artha Nivritti. in the sense that here's where one starts to work on getting rid of the blocks in our Krishna consciousness, the anarthas. 16 anarthas, what are the anarthas? The anarthas that come by way of offenses, anarthas that come by way of sinful activities, anarthas that come by way of pious activities, and anarthas in the process of bhakti itself, philosophical misconceptions, or just general ignorance of the process of bhakti. This is a whole, I just gave a 5-hour class just a few days ago in the Goshala on the 9 stages of bhakti. We talked about this particular aspect of that 9 stages for about an hour and a half. So I'll just go through it because I want to get to the essence of how to get rid of the anarthas. And the main qualities or the main anarthas that we struggle with are the ones that are the most detrimental to our spiritual life are the anarthas that are in the category of offenses. Offenses to the Lord, that is, offenses to the deity, offenses to the holy name, offenses to Vaishnavas, and offenses to people in general. These are the 4 categories of the offenses. Now, in the offenses to the holy name, we can never really get past this stage of offenseless chanting unless we work on the 11th offense. Every day in the temple, we recite the 10 offenses. And we also mention the 11th offense. And what is the 11th offense? Inattentive chanting. So Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur gives a little indication how to become free from the other 10 offenses and all offenses by practicing the 11th. In other words, avoiding the 11th offense. Attentive chanting. He says, by attentive chanting, the inclination to commit the other offenses is reduced practically to nothing. Because attentive chanting actually brings the consciousness to a higher stage of existence where one will not be inclined to commit offenses and one will have the intelligence how to avoid even what we say unconscious offenses. And so, he makes that point and emphasizes this in his discussion on this particular verse. And what does he say? He says there's 3 types of inattention. In Sanskrit, they're called vikshepa, audakshina, and jadya. Vikshepa means distraction. The mind gets distracted and starts to dwell on other subjects while one is chanting. I think that's common. We start thinking about, when I'm done, you know, what I'm going to do when I'm done, or what I forgot to do yesterday. In other words, there's a whole gamut of things that the mind can dwell on while one is chanting. Now, that is called distraction. The other offense is called audakshina. Audakshina means there's 2 different terms that are used, English words. One is lackadaisicalness, or what we say, no enthusiasm. In other words, one is chanting, but it's just the words are just coming out, but there's nothing. There's no real enthusiasm. And more like you say, if you fire a gun, but the gun only has blanks. There's nothing really happening, just a lot of noise. So because we lack enthusiasm in the process of chanting, we're more or less trying to get the chanting finished. And so that audakshina, inertia, lackadaisicalness, the actual word is apathy. That's the actual definition. One is apathetic. I do it because it's an instruction coming from my spiritual master. I do it because I've been doing it for years. In other words, not seeing the reason why and not being enthusiastic in the process of chanting. And the last one is jagya. Jagya means sleep. One becomes overcome with the mood of sleep during the chanting. And one cannot really focus on chanting. And so Bhakti Vinod Thakur gives some antidotes, or we say remedies, for each of these anarthas. He says for distraction, the best thing is recommended is to go to a place where devotees are chanting and sit down near those persons who are enthusiastic to chant. In other words, get that association of enthusiastic chanters. Now we might also say, well, that's not always practical or possible. Then one should do whatever they can in their own environment to create an atmosphere where distraction is minimized. And that is called, Satchinandana Maharaj mentions, create the sacred space. Make a place where there's no opportunity to get distracted, either internally or externally. Internally, there will be some distractions, but then the external environment should be conducive to help our mind become, again, focused. If you chant in the place where you do your day-to-day activities, you'll also see the objects of your day-to-day activities, which will attract your mind to that, you know, to think about what you're going to do later with that object. So it's recommended sacred space, a place where you can simply focus and the atmosphere is conducive for chanting. Have deities there, have the holy name there, have the atmosphere free from external, when we say, attacks from the outside, like that. But he mentions distraction is mostly overcome by proper association. He also says the remedy for audakshina or apathy is also the same. Find that those persons who are enthusiastic and sit down and chant with them. That we can work on an internal basis. We should see that if we're trying to simply finish our chanting, as opposed to going deeper into the sound of the holy name and trying to access the mood of bhakti through devotion and through forcing the mind to hear very carefully, we will simply not get very much out of our chanting. We'll simply just get it done. So I think the most biggest death to japa is the consciousness of trying to finish. Just trying to finish. And it comes up, but if it comes up, don't allow it to stay. Again, refocus on the importance of chanting and the enthusiasm for chanting. Pray to the Lord for His mercy during the chanting, begging. This is another symptom of humility. Humility can be acquiesced, or what we say acquired, mostly in the time when we chant our japa, because the holy name descends, and therefore what will make it descend when the Lord is pleased by our approach to holy name? And how we approach that is our humble attitude, being in a position of begging for the mercy of the holy name. So that begging can come out in the form of various prayers. We have prayers to the japa beads. We've seen those prayers. I sent them on the conference for those of you who are there. Prayers to the japa beads, prayers to the Lord, prayers to Lord Chaitanya, prayers to the spiritual master. Prayers to the holy name itself. All these prayers can be done before we chant or even during the japa in order to increase our dependence on the mercy of the Lord and go deeper into the mood of chanting. So it's a sacred act of chanting. So if we can overcome this principle of inattention, we will see a fast acceleration of our spiritual growth, very fast. Because this is what's retarding most of our process, because attentive japa expands itself into everything we do. Into everything we do. In Jada, in sleep, he says that If you're feeling tired, then do something to stay awake. In other words, you can, what devotees do is sometimes we get up and we walk around. Walking around also increases the opportunity to become distracted. But in some cases, it can help keep one awake like that. But then Bhaktivinoda Thakur explains that if you feel too tired and your sleep is becoming so strong, better to chant at another time and get sufficient rest. So then he makes these three points in how to overcome this this tendency for inattention. If we can attend, we can increase the attention of our japa, we will increase our whole process of Krishna consciousness. And humility is not separate from that, because in order to increase the quality of the japa, one cannot approach the Lord in any way but humble. There's no other way to approach the Lord. On the higher levels of bhakti, when one is situated in their rasa with Krishna, then that's a different thing. Then one may also have a relationship with Krishna in a very intimate and loving way. But until we get to that, we can express that love through the mood of humility and dependency like that. So Lord Chaitanya says, I'm overcome with offenses. I have no qualifications to chant. What is my situation? Just look at me. And then he goes on to the next verse. And this verse is the solution to all the problems. And I think Bhuta Bhavana covered one of the main points of that verse, Trinadapi Sunichena Tayor Ivasahishuna Amanina Mamanadena Kirtaniya Siddhati. How important this verse is, it's impossible to describe. Srila Krishna Das Kaviraj Goswami explains that humility, tolerance, pridelessness, and respect for others are the foundation of a devotee's qualities. This allows one to move forward nicely in Krishna consciousness and always have very pleasant and wonderful dealings with each and every living being, whether it's inside the spiritual family or even the broader family in the material world. So what is that? What are those qualities? How do they develop? It's called cultivation. One has to cultivate these qualities along with the process of bhakti. There's no question of humility outside of devotional service. Persons who are humble in the material world are also, these are forms of personal, in other words, material qualifications that look like spiritual qualifications are under the influence of the modes of material nature. And that's explained in the fifth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, that the non-devotees, although they have so many apparent good qualities, because they're under the influence of the modes of material nature, their good qualities are shifting according to the natures of the modes. The modes are always changing. So a person may be kind to their family members, but not kind to someone outside of there. Or might be kind to humans, but not to animals, or to animals and not to humans. There are people like that, very kind to animals, but they don't like human beings. But they don't get along. I've seen that so many times like that. The material aspect of the good qualities are actually considered not to be good qualities. They have to be focused along with the process of chanting the holy names of the Lord. And this is mentioned by the Acharyas. I'll have to read one point here. So I would like to continue a little bit about this quality of humility that Bhuta Bhavana really went deep into, but it's unlimited. There's humility that comes by way of one's understanding of one's natural position. when you understand who we are and what is our actual position, you can't be anything else but humble. The word jiva, translated, the living entity in the material world is called jiva. So jiva means finite, and jiva also means that which can become overcome, small, tiny. So the jiva is always overcome by the material energy. Unless the jiva connects with the spiritual energy, and then the jiva is no longer subjected to the influence of the overcoming of the material energy. But what is that connection? That connection, as Buddha Bhavana Prabhu mentioned, is dependent on the mercy of the Lord. So dependence means humility. Dependence means humility. You can't be dependent on someone unless you acquiesce to their control. You can't say, well, I'll be dependent on you, but I'll do whatever I like. It doesn't work. So depending on the mercy of the Lord means to depend on the Lord's instructions that come by way of the execution of the devotional service of the Lord. There's another kind of humility, humility arising out of one's remorse because of attachment to sense gratification. We talked about how not to wallow in one's own, what we say, disqualifications, and develop a sense of lamentation based on that, which causes one to become inert or aggressive. But when one looks back to one's situation and sees, how many lifetimes have I rejected you, my Lord? How many times in this life did I have a chance to serve you, but I chose not to? How many times that I could have associated with devotees, but I took the opportunities for sense gratification. In other words, when we look back on our own activities, we become somewhat unhappy. Oh, I wasted so much time. Oh, I was ungrateful. Oh, I didn't accept your mercy. One becomes remorseful. And then there's another kind of remorse, which is even greater. My dear Lord, what am I doing in this place? I left you. You are my eternal well-wisher and the source of my happiness in all respects. I came here to try to become like you and try to enjoy separate from you. What a fool I am. And then that kind of remorsefulness helps one to become humble. Oh, all right, I made a mistake. I'm a fool. I don't want to do it again. See, without the humility, the tendency to repeat the same mistake occurs. If one, sometimes people try to cover over their mistakes by thinking, oh, okay, I made a mistake, but I'm not going to do it again. And then they go on making their plans how to avoid that mistake. But that won't work, because the tendency is we're driven by our consciousness to think and act in a certain way. And we make the same mistakes again. And I think Bhupta Bhavana Prabhu pointed this out. The only way we can redirect that course back to the Lord in a, what we say, a steadfast way, is to realize I can't change myself. I need your help. I need your mercy. I can make the effort, but your mercy is the difference. Therefore, in my efforts to change myself, I depend on you. How do I depend on you? And coming, your mercy coming through the spiritual teachers, your mercy coming through the devotees, and your mercy also coming through my experiences in this life. What is that experience? I learn by my mistakes. I learn by my mistakes, and I try to avoid my mistakes, but I'll make the same mistake again unless I fall flat in dependence on your mercy. And one of the ways to become humble, and it's so simple, but it's simple in explanation, maybe difficult to do. Prabhupada said, if you always remember the lotus feet of the Lord, You will never be impeded in any activity in devotional service. Simply by, not surreptitiously, but what's the word? When you take something and you place it on your mind, what is that called? To transport, to... It starts with an S. Supplant, or in other words, take the thought of the Lord's lotus feet and stick it in your mind. Keep it there. Actually, if you can put a sign with a little cardboard, you can put two little holes so you can see where you're going. But the main vision is the feet. It might be considered a little unusual. But it actually is good medicine. If we can remember the lotus feet of the Lord, because the lotus feet of the Lord is not simply a remembrance of the Lord, it's endowed with all the mercy of the Lord also. So that humility that comes by, we say, our own personal failures, depending on the Lord. Now, another type of humility is when you actually have good qualities and you have many achievements in your life and people have recognized those achievements. I think Buddha Bhagavan Prabhu covered that with Rupa Goswami, very qualified. They came, Sanatana Goswami, Rupa Goswami, from a Saraswat Brahmin family, which is the highest form of Brahminical culture at that time. And so they were respected by the Brahminical community. And they were respected by everybody. They had aristocracy, they had respect, they had followers, they had good intelligence, they were expert in various types of languages. But yet, it didn't cause any type of pride. So humility that comes by way of having something, and at the same time one remains humble, despite one's immense good qualities, that's a type of humility that's really glorious. It's very, you don't see that in the material world. Usually you see if a person is very much qualified, they become more proud and more arrogant and more, what we say, want to throw their influences into more and more places. But a devotee knows, without your mercy, my dear Lord, what is the use of others? And with your mercy, my dear Lord, what is the use of others? That's a prayer. That's a prayer by Srila Bilva Mangala Thakur. He says, my dear Lord, with your mercy, I don't need anybody else's. And without your mercy, what will other persons at mercy do? I don't want it. I'd rather have no mercy than someone else's mercy, because that mercy will just bring me down. So he only wants the Lord's mercy. He's praying. So the devotee, Prabhupada used the example, devotee is like a chitaka bird. A chitaka bird is a bird that flies close to the clouds and drinks the water only when the cloud dispenses the water. The bird will wait till the cloud actually gives the water before the bird will drink. Now the cloud might give lightning and thunder, or the sky might. The bird will not become discouraged. He'll wait for the water from the cloud. The bird will get thirsty and see the water on the ground, but will not go for that water, although it's drinkable. It'll only work. So the devotee says, my dear Lord, I only want your mercy. So that mercy is the success of our life. So what is that mercy? I think Buddha Bhagavan mentioned grace. Grace, what is the difference between grace and mercy? This is an interesting thing. Mercy is something you make some effort and something is received by. Grace comes by way of the good qualities of the person giving. Even without your own efforts. In other words, if a rich man wants to benedict someone who's very poor and unqualified, he can do that. What is the qualification of that person to receive that person's wealth or gifts? Nothing but the choice of that person. That's all. So if the Lord wants, or if the spiritual master wants, they can benedict anyone with the Lord's mercy, and that's called grace. Grace. How do you earn grace? You don't. You simply... But humility is a type of earning. When one sees one as humility, and humility attracts the attention of the Lord. Humility is so powerful that it's considered bhakti in itself. Out of all the qualifications of a Vaishnava, humility is the topmost, because it actually is bhakti in action. Well, humility means receptivity. Receptive to the mercy of the Lord, receptive to the instructions of the Lord, like that. Sometimes we see people who have external signs of humility and how they act and how they conduct themselves in different situations. That may be humility or may not be. It may be a symptom of their way of dealing in such a way as to get what they want. The humility of the non-devotees is a principle in order to acquire something. It's good business to be humble. But a devotee that doesn't think like that, devotee knows humility is pleasing to the Lord, and it puts me in my rightful position. Therefore, devotees don't use humility as a feature to gain something. Oh, I think I'll be humble now that way. I'll get what I want. I'll get some praise. I'll get some notice like that. I mean, I'm so humble, I'm proud of it. Sometimes we joke like that. So, yeah, but humility is actually a feature of the soul's relationship with Krishna. It's the foundation. Therefore, in the Bhagavad Gita, when Krishna describes the 20 items of knowledge in the 13th chapter, he says, amanitam adambitam. He says, humility and pridelessness he mentions first. So these are the qualifications that attract the attention of the Lord. As one makes advancement in Krishna consciousness, true advancement, humility will start to manifest simply by one's advancement. Because advancement also means advancement of knowledge. And as knowledge is gained, one starts to see one's position in relationship to other living entities, to the material energy, and ultimately to the Lord, like that. So humility comes also by one's spiritual advancement. So this third verse, Charnadapi Sunichena Tayori Vasi Hishnina Amanina Namanadena Kirtaniya Sadalehi. Srila Krishna Das Kaviraj Goswami says that the holy name is like a necklace, and the qualifications or the qualities of humility When used in chanting the holy name are like an ornament on that necklace. It makes the necklace even more attractive. One's outstanding ornament. So he gives very high glorification to the quality of humility. He says, string this verse on the necklace of the holy name and wear it as your ornament, he says. So, but, I mean, look at Srila Prabhupada. I mean, some people criticize him for being a little bit insensitive, arrogant. You know, he would use strong language. But can we say he wasn't humble? So as Buddha Bhavana Prabhu mentions, that humility also means a type of boldness, but boldness from Krishna. There's not an iota or even a speck of one's own personal. If one is using boldness in order to be bold, in order to attract attention or to exhibit some kind of feature of one's own characteristics, then that interferes with the actual principle of man. One should be bold for Krishna. In other words, the spiritual master gives the instruction to preach. So in order to be preached, sometimes you have to be strong. You have to speak the truth. People don't like to hear the truth. They like to hear the truth inside of some kind of candy-coated, what we say, package. But Prabhupada wasn't a candy-coater. And therefore, sometimes people say, we can't really listen to Prabhupada. He's just too heavy. But if you listen carefully, you'll see inside of his words, there's compassion and concern. There's a type of deep concern for the welfare of others. And also the mood of teaching, which is instructive for everyone who hears. In other words, he's teaching what we should not be. When you teach, you have to do two things. You have to speak the positive, and you also have to tell people to avoid the negative. If you only speak the positive, by their own ways of doing things, they will fall back into their old patterns of negativity. So reminding people what they're not supposed to do is part of the principle of preaching. So that boldness sometimes looks like, you know, criticism or arrogance. But if you know the individual, then if the individual has the mood of compassion, and you're convinced about that, we have that understanding with Prabhupada, we know that his boldness was simply another form of his compassion, born out of his natural humility and devotion. Okay, so I think Buddha Bhavana covered humility really nicely. I didn't want him to end. I was really getting a lot of that. Theoretical knowledge fosters pride. Wisdom fosters humility. The importance of going deeper into the philosophy and not just remembering the philosophy and repeating it just because this is the truth. One should try to understand theoretically. Wisdom comes by way of understanding and application. When you practice what you hear in terms of the knowledge you receive, you gradually get an understanding, and that becomes a realization. So wisdom is one step above theoretical knowledge, and that brings humility. One who is wise can develop it. One who has theoretical knowledge means I know a lot of stuff, I can remember a lot of stuff, I've read a lot of stuff. Do you know what it means? No. I mean, we can't blame a person who has theoretical knowledge because it's a stage. But it's stage one. It's not the complete aspect of knowledge. Knowledge is called vigyan or gyan. And then there's vigyan. Vigyan means vishishta gyan. Vishishta means that knowledge which is realized knowledge. Realized knowledge comes by application of theoretical knowledge and practice. So hearing, and therefore, it's important to ask questions, to get clarifications on the knowledge we receive so we can apply that knowledge to our day-to-day practice. And many of us receive the same knowledge, but how does it apply to me in my particular situation accordingly? And then there's where questions are important, to get clarification, understanding, and then one can move forward nicely. And then theoretical knowledge turns into wisdom. Okay, so this third verse also has another element, two more elements, and that is tolerance. Lord Chaitanya says, more tolerant than the tree. He uses the tree. Tree is given a lot of emphasis throughout the spiritual literature. Trees are glorified in so many different ways as very magnanimous living beings. They give and ask very little. They give their fruits, they give shade, they give their wood for building houses, their houses for living entities in themselves, as much as animals and birds. The tree is very compassionate and it's very tolerant. The woodcutter comes, sits underneath the tree, takes the benefit of the shade of the tree, eats the fruit of the tree, and then cuts the tree down. The tree doesn't protest. Tolerant like the tree. So Lord Chaitanya says in this particular verse, not to be like a tree, but to be more tolerant than a tree. So, how do you how does it be more tolerant than the tree? There's two types of tolerance. The Shastras give us two categories of tolerance, and they're quite distinct. One is the tolerance that comes simply by living in this world. And that verse is the verse in the Bhagavad Gita from the second chapter. Marta sparsas tu kunteya, sit nusna sukadukada, agapayina nityas tamstitiksma. The non-permanent appearance of happiness and distress and their disappearance in due course of time are like the appearance and disappearance of the winter and summer seasons. They arise from sense perception, and Krishna speaking to Arjuna, O skin of Bart, and one should learn to tolerate them without becoming a disturbed. So there's heat, we have to tolerate, cold, we have to tolerate other living entities. We have to tolerate so many things, just the way life is. You make a plan, it doesn't work out, something else happens, you have to learn to tolerate reverses in life. Tolerance is such a major principle of life that unless one develops tolerance, one cannot live. But tolerance is such a glorious quality that it says that Prabhupada made this statement that a greatness of a person can be estimated by how they can learn to tolerate in all circumstances. So a person becomes great by what we say others when they have a very, very high degree of tolerance. So that tolerance that comes by way of life itself, tolerating the difficulties, tolerating the, I think Buddha Bhagavan was mentioning, I was trying to reflect on how when we start coming up with our own ideas on how to do things, that's mentioned in the scripture as being haunted by a ghost. Yeah, the story of Sarvagya in the Chaitanya Charitamrita. The mental speculation is like being haunted by a ghost. The mind is saying, hey, it's giving you all kinds of ideas. That's some ghost. That's all it is. So the idea is to take instructions and guidance from persons who are qualified to give that and applying in your life like that and learning through that application how to go forward. So this idea of mental speculation means I can do it. So therefore there's a quality called Shastra Chakshus, seeing through the eyes of scripture, seeing through the eyes of Guru. In other words, applying the teachings in the day-to-day life, how to see things. I see something, but is that really the way I'm supposed to see? I want to do something, but let me take the advice of those who know. In other words, I mean, on a practical level from our day-to-day life in the material world, we can use material understandings how to, you know, how to do things, how to build a house, how to cook a a meal like that. All these things are practical, and they're learned by experience and from others. But when it comes to spiritual life, we have to be guided by higher knowledge on every aspect. And that guidance sort of gives the mind a certain mindset where we can always apply principles in each and every situation. What I see or what I experience may not be what I see and experience, may be completely different. And it is, usually. For instance, when we see an individual, what do we see? Well, we might see that person according to their material definitions or our conception of that person. But do we actually see according to the verse in the Bhagavad Gita, Vidya Vinaya Sampane, Brahmani Gavi Hastini Suni Chaiva Svapakecha Pandita Samadarshanaha? So one who sees with knowledge sees that all living entities are part and parcel of Krishna. There's a spirit soul in each and every body, whether it's a dog, an insect, a dog eater, an elephant, a Brahmin. In other words, they see the soul along with seeing that individual in that particular body. But they focus on the spiritual. So that's actually vision. So therefore, when we simply depend on mental speculation, it says we're being haunted by a ghost. Okay, tolerance. There's another kind of tolerance, and that is Lord Brahma mentions that in the 10th chapter, 14th verse, number 8. What's the first word? Tate nukampa susimiksamanam bhujane vakritam vipakam vidva vahubir vidada namaste jivetiyo mukti padesha dayaba. This is for the devotees. This verse says, my dear Lord, you have given me some difficulties. Actually, this is your mercy. In fact, what you've given me and the suffering that I've gotten from this is much less than I actually deserve. I actually deserve much more. So not only do I deserve much more, but thank you for giving me this. And then, what's the last line when one prays like that? Mukti Padesha Dayaba. Prabhupada says, you're born into a very rich family, and you're simply the son or the daughter of a wealthy person. You get the inheritance simply because you were born in that family. In other words, you inherit the kingdom of God. That verse is so powerful, or the application of the principles in that verse allows one to actually achieve the qualifications to go back home, back to Godhead. And what was I going to say? Prabhupada said, yeah, he said you should learn two mantras, the Hare Krishna mantra and this verse. And then you can practice Krishna consciousness. Because most of them, it's the 10th canto, 14th chapter, verse number 8. It was spoken by Lord Brahma after Krishna bewildered Brahma, when Brahma tried to steal the calves and cowherd boys. And then Krishna created another set, and Brahma was bewildered by Krishna's creation. And then Krishna manifested all the cowherd boys and calves that he expanded himself into Vishnu forms. And Brahma saw all these Vishnu forms in the form of the cowherd boys and calves. And he realized there was nothing non-different. So Brahma has a tendency to become a little bit, what we say, overwhelmed by his position, to use a nice word. And he used that, what we say, pride, to try to play a trick on Krishna. But Krishna played a trick on him. And after he was somewhat humiliated, he offered these beautiful prayers, and that was one of the prayers. My dear Lord, you have given me some punishment because of what I did, but actually I deserve much worse. So Prabhupada said, if we can learn to pray like that, so that's a kind of tolerance that is given by the Lord. just to purify us, just to move and make us move forward in the process of bhakti like that. How to recognize that? You can see it when it comes by way of your devotional service. The other kind of tolerance is simply the things that come by way of living in this world. But Krishna is giving that directly. He's doing that to help the devotee move forward like that. Because we can't really develop these good qualities unless we are put in a position to practice it. If you want to be humble, in one sense, you have to be forced into the situation where humility is the only solution in that situation. Same with tolerance, like that. So this is mentioned here. This tolerance is a feature of seeing everything happening not as the results of one's past karma, but coming directly from Krishna as a means of purification and direction. The Lord certainly knows what is best for me. Dayabhak and Mukti Padesh means liberation and divine service is the result. One inherits that simply by that mood. The tree is firmly deep rooted. Okay, that's something else. Tolerance also extends out as a compassion for others. So one learns to tolerate, then one can start to see how to be an instrument to relieve the suffering of others. We're always worried, as I think Buddha Bhavana mentioned, we're always overwhelmed with our own situation. We can't really see how to be an instrument towards God's mercy for others. Any questions on humility or tolerance? Yes.
Thank you much for the point you're making. I wanted to ask, are there limits to tolerance as a practicing devotee? In other words,
Christ answered that question. When Christ was asked, how much should we tolerate? Seven? He said, 7 times 70.
I mean, just in the general sense that sometimes things are favorable, unfavorable. When does a devotee know, okay, now we shouldn't be in this situation?
Tolerance doesn't mean you just accept everything because it's coming. Tolerance means to learn how to accept it in the mood of devotion. So if there's something that can be, if something is coming your way and you can use it to educate some others, then that form of tolerance can be used as devotional service. We don't tolerate ignorance. You can see Prabhupada. When Prabhupada was when people would speak some philosophy that was not in line with bhakti, he would be very, we might say, enthusiastic to smash it. You might say he was very intolerant of anything that was outside of the bhakti realm, in a very, what we say, he let you know, this is wrong. But he's simply protecting, Krishna's interests. He's keeping us in line with the Siddhanta, so we don't get diverted by something that looks like the Siddhanta. One of the anarthas is to see certain principles that are not bhakti to be bhakti. that are not bhakti to be bhakti. In other words, things that filter in from other traditions that look like they're very nice, but actually they're only in the different modes, in the modes of goodness or passion. They have some material benefit, but they don't have anything to do with the process of, spiritual knowledge. Does that help? Did that answer your question?
Yes. I was wanting to speak, ask you, Maharaj, about humbling that you were mentioning, and you said that materialists are more selfishly looking into it and the world is unselfishly. And I know before you said also that
I'll repeat the question.
So you mentioned once lecture before that also we are also under the level of materialist until we go to the above the level of anarchic.
Not really. We're not on the level of the materialists. We might be influenced by material qualities or material thoughts, but because we're practicing devotional service, we're mixed. So I think your question is, are we actually practicing humility in the right way?
No, is it okay to look at us also as a materialist, not qualified like that, so that we're
No, we're not materialists. As long as you're in the process of bhakti, you're actually on the platform of liberation, but your consciousness hasn't reached that stage. Bhakti is pure, but we're not pure. So we're performing something pure in an impure way. So we're getting some benefit, but not the full benefit. So this is called Karma Mishra Bhakta or Jnana Mishra Bhakta. That bhakti that's mixed with material tendencies or material ideas. In other words, I'll give you an example. Fruit of activities. We're doing something in order to get some material result. We do that in devotional service. We're attached to the results. Attached to the result is an influence of the material energy. Devotee performs the activity for the pleasure of the Lord, and the results are for the benefit of the Lord. Whether the results are favorable or unfavorable, it's not the question. The question is, am I doing my service favorable or unfavorable? The results are up to Krishna. So sometimes devotees get discouraged when they don't get the results from their activities. They either change their activities or go away, either one, or become unhappy with the results. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, karmana varikaraste ma phalechu kadachana ma karma phalahetu vur ma te sangosa karmani. You have a right to perform your duty, but you're not entitled to the results of activities. Never consider yourself the cause of your activities and never be attached to not doing your duty. So you have to do your service, but at the same time, the results are not up to you. So when we get attached to the results and become elated or despondent by the results, that's material consciousness. It's tinged by the mode of passion. So, but we're not materialists. No, no sense of the word. No. Okay. And you had, there was a bunch of questions, but he was next, and then Susanna after that.
Maharaj, in this verse, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says that we should be more toward the tree, and as an individual, I can understand that I should be more toward the tree, if people are important to me. But if I see that somebody is not tolerant to our scriptures or blasphemy.
No, that's not tolerance, that's ignorance. If somebody's saying, someone is blaspheming the scriptures or another devotee or speaking, you should speak. You should be tolerant to the fact that they're ignorant and not blame them so much, but you have to attack what they're saying, or you have to counteract what they're saying. Yeah, the people have this general. I think sometimes I see that when Indian people come to the West, they develop this false sense of humility and tolerance that they should just accept everything because it's Western culture. But that doesn't really solve the problem. Susanna? A little louder. This is something we should strive for.
How can that be worthy for their own mindset, which results in being upset by not getting, but
well, you should, if you're feeling like you're not acting right, or you keep making the same mistakes, is that it? Well, you can lament about what you're doing and what you're not able to achieve, but that's not going to solve the problem. Intelligently try to see what is the solution and work on it. Krishna consciousness is cultivation. As soon as you see a situation that needs correction, the tendency a lot of times is we want to correct it immediately. And that's not wrong, but it just doesn't work like that. And the thing is, you have to work on it. Like, this verse is not about, okay, all of a sudden you have to be tolerant like a tree, humbler like a grass, free from all pride. It means this is what you have to work on. It's called, this is the cultivating verse. It gets you free from the tendency to commit offenses. It helps you get over the anarthas that you're dealing with. It allows you to move forward in spiritual life in a very progressive way by developing the qualities of a Vaishnava. So it's a cultivation. If you fail, keep trying. Prabhupada said, third class to fall down, first class to get back up. That means we think, oh, I failed, I can't do it. That means you think it's about you. You don't understand that it's the mercy that's going to make the difference, and not your effort will bring about the mercy. But without the mercy, the success doesn't manifest. And we can also look, oh, how to get over, take association. This is what, when you associate with devotees who have these qualities, you develop them faster. When you serve those devotees and associate, yeah. But if you're not getting proper association, it's very hard, a regular association, it's very hard to move forward. Yes, way in the back, Mataji.
Mataji, you mentioned about tolerance.
Can you stand up, please? Thank you.
You mentioned about tolerance, right? It doesn't mean that you have to accept everything. You have to accept it in the mood of devotion.
Well, you have to see what's coming your way, yeah.
Can you give an example of accepting tolerance in the mood of devotion?
In the mood of intelligence, I think. That's a better word. Like, I think Bhuta Bhavana was mentioning that when something happens to you, you should understand there's something about you that caused that element to come your way. So developing a tolerance to the situation allows you to become introspective towards what is that thing about me that brought about this situation. Helps you to become reflective, and then when you reflect, you start to think. And Krishna in your heart is also there helping you to understand. I mean, sometimes we look at the situation, we can't find a reason why it's happening. But you might say the ultimate reason is that by practicing tolerance in this situation, I can chant the holy name better. I mean, if you go to India, I mean, there's where you really learn tolerance, right? It's just, yeah, if you really want a lesson in, you know, tolerance, PhD style, you go to India. There's so much to tolerate, especially Indian trains, right? But by practicing the principle of tolerance in the general sense, we can approach the holy name. It helps to help us to approach the holy. Just accepting the mood of tolerance is very beneficial to the chanting of the holy name. Maria?
Thank you very much. I have the question,
How to walk all qualities, because...
How to?
How to walk all qualities.
Qualities.
Yes, how to develop these good qualities, because sometimes you hear lectures, yes, and you see that I need this quality, this quality, this quality, and then the mind becomes confused what to develop.
Which one first?
Yes, which one first? Or should we...
You can choose. I think we mentioned humility as being a primary quality. I think humility, I think Prabhupada's statement, as Buddha Bhavan and Prabhu mentioned in the Bhagavad Gita, not wanting the distinction to be honored by others. People want to honor you and you also like to be honored. If you actually don't want that, that's a quality of humility. That's one of the cultivations of humility. That's one. The other one is dependence on the mercy of the Lord. That's a quality, that's a feature of humility. Always being dependent. Dependent means you have to be reflective in the way you think. If you're so spontaneous that every time you do something in your life, you just do it on automatic pilot, and you don't think and reflect about what is going to be. Prabhupada said the indication of an intelligent person, he will see the results before the activity. He will look, oh, if I say this, what will be the response? If I do this, what will happen? That's a quality of intelligence, to see the results before the activity. And then that one way where one can adjust or proceed accordingly. Yeah, so in practicing these qualities, we have to kind of like, I think one of the features of practicing Krishna consciousness in the Western countries is that we are really so much influenced by the modes of passion and ignorance. So we have a tendency to do a lot of things and we not do a lot of things fast. Spiritual life really means to slow down. Some of us don't like that. To slow down and be thoughtful and reflective, both in our own situation and in the situation around us. When you're thoughtful, you get so many realizations of... But we even think, you know, Prabhupada's motto was simple living, high thinking. But this world is high living, no thinking. No time to think because we're too busy living. Right? So slow down in whatever we're doing and then time to reflect. And that brings about a better ambience in relationships when we're not so much in a hurry to do things, but we're in a hurry to develop a relationship with the people we do it with. Radhanath Swami made a nice statement. He made it here in the House of Lords, or the House of, what's the other house? House of Commons, I think it was the first one. He said, we have a tendency to love things and use people, as opposed to loving people and using things. I don't think devotees do that so much, but whatever element is still there, it can be eradicated by understanding the importance of a relationship over activity. The relationships are more important than the activities that come by developing relationships. And the activities helps to develop relationship, no doubt. But it's the relationship that makes all the activities wonderful. With the devotees, with Krishna, with the spiritual master. If there's no connection with anyone through the activity and one just performs the activity mindlessly or what we say mechanically, that's why some people ask, how can I get away from this mechanical devotional service? Well, when you see behind every activity there's a personality you're trying to please or trying to interact with, then you get away from the impersonal and mechanical way of doing things. There was one devotee. I don't know, this is an interesting story. He was asked to give a lecture. And so he never gave a lecture before. So he was thinking, I can't speak. So what he did is he connected a tape recorder with earphones to his ears with Prabhupada's class. And he had a hat he put over it so you couldn't see the... And he would push the button and then hear what Prabhupada said and then he would say it. And then he would... And he'd push a button again and say the next line. He gave the whole class exactly according to what Prabhupada said. Everyone said, nice class. But he really wasn't relating to anybody. He was just relating to the talk that he was hearing. That's, he wasn't, what we say, responsive to the audience, the fact that there was people out there who were listening who have a certain, you know, receptivity. So we can do things mechanically or we can do things according to how best we perceive we can make a difference in that activity. So we should try for that. That's part of the process of cultivation. Cultivating like that. Cultivating. Krishna consciousness is not about perfection. It is. But cultivating the mood that brings about perfection. And these are the qualities. This verse is actually the qualities that help make devotional service wonderful. Perfect. Another question? I thought I saw another hand. Sri Devi?
When Sachinathan Maharaj said that you can take Kiva Dhati, but you can't take tolerance. And at that point, he could some explanation about that. And the second part of my question is...
Well, that's obvious answer. When you have to tolerate something, you can't fake it. It's real. Either you tolerate or you don't. Humility, you can make a show. Yeah. It's obvious, right? If something comes your way and you have to tolerate, you can't fake it. If you're faking it, that means you're not tolerating it. Or you're trying to put it, yeah, you just can't fake it. It's happening. You have to react one way or the other. Yeah. You don't look happy with that answer. You should ask Maharaj then. See what he says. You can ask Nitya Kishori, she'll probably answer that question. She knows Maharaj. Do you have an answer for that one? No? Okay. Yes. Second part.
Where does tolerance end and abuse begin? Because in the name of tolerance, so many abusive situations have occurred.
You want to handle that one? I think I'm being abused by that question. Abusing the speaker. I'm just kidding, don't worry. Where does tolerance and abuse begin? You have to see by the experience whether it's actually something you can tolerate or if it's actually coming in abusive nature. Something is abusive, and then you'll be naturally resistant to that. I mean, but there are levels of tolerance that go higher and higher. Haridas Thakura was being beaten in 22 marketplaces, but at the same time, he wasn't accepting it as abuse. He was accepting it as an opportunity to deliver the abusers by praying for their deliverance. And he was also thinking, you know, because of my past sinful activities, I'm being punished. So, but you can't imitate that. That's just an example. Prabhupada said, don't try to imitate Haridas Thakur's tolerance, Sanatana Goswami's humility, Damodar Pandit's ability to criticize, and what's the last one? Ramananda Roy's consciousness of being undisturbed in all situations. So these are examples of high levels of those qualities. So what's, if something is abusive, I mean, what does the word abusive mean? It means it's just going to bring you down. It's mean-spirited. Something is abusive, it's coming from a mean spirit. Okay, anything else? Okay.
This question I was also wanted to ask Buddha Bhavani before, it's about familiarity. And because you were speaking about respect, how humility, we don't respect from others something that we should not respect, but how to behave in such a way and that the familiarity doesn't develop, especially in Balkan areas when people are have a lot of friendship and relationships. With each other, familiarity grows very...
If you see your familiarity is causing you to be less respectful to that person, that means it's gone too far. When you lose respect for a person, then you actually don't appreciate them. And then you just either use them or, what we say, neglect them. Or you... So familiarity means going beyond the proper etiquette in the relationship. And then that familiarity causes you to lose respect or to minimize the person. Friendship is different than familiarity. To be friendly is great. It's actually wanted. But familiar means that you just take advantage of another person's relationship. It happens sometimes, a lot of times. But if you're, you know, sometimes you can really get really close and we might say familiar with a person and at the same time not lose respect for them. But that's difficult. The tendency is, unless we're on a high platform of bhakti, we will lose respect. You see, you know, like Lord Nityananda and Advaita Acharya were joking with each other and calling each other different names. Apparently very derogatory names. But their familiarity was done in deep form of intimacy because of that. When people are very close, in that sometimes their familiarity is actually a sign of their relationship with each other. But you can't impose familiarity on another person and expect that development to a relationship. It has to be something that comes by way of reciprocal. If you get familiar with the spiritual master, you will lose respect for the spiritual master after a while. You get from maybe, there's an etiquette in relationships and we should honor that etiquette. But what is the principle that makes the relationship alive is the sense of respect. As soon as we lose respect for another person, then we, the relationship gravitates to something negative. Or we lose that relationship. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur gives that as the foundation for happiness. He says, I live in this world happily because I do one thing, I give respect to everyone. And what is he respecting? He is respecting that individual's right to exist and the fact that that individual is part and parcel of Krishna. So in common parlance, there is also a type of etiquette that comes by way of speech. that allows this respect, then that should be honored too, how we speak to each other like that. And sometimes we bridge that gap, but if it's done regularly, then it's a qualification, a disqualification in developing, you know, actual relationships. And cultures are different. If you go around the world, people have a different type of way they respect and interact with each other, slightly different. You know, certain cultures, they argue with each other, and that's the way they talk. They're always arguing, but that's a form of communication. So, you know, there's cultural differences. But then follow the etiquette according to Vaishnava culture. Susanna. You forgot the question? You preach to?
Preach to, I don't know, students or something.
Uh-huh.
And we face the problem of not being patient enough.
Impatience?
And maybe it's due to not proper sadhana or something. You are not feeling strong inside, maybe you are not saying. But you accept the thing that that person also gets a reaction, and you also get a reaction because of your past behavior.
You're trying to preach to someone and they're not accepting it? Is that what you're saying?
Something like that. Or not.
So, what can you do? You try different means to reach those individuals, and you depend on Krishna, that's all. And sometimes you just have to go to another place. When they say if you throw seeds on dry ground, they won't grow. If you throw seeds on fertile, moist ground, they grow very fast. Yes, right behind you.
Could you please explain again the difference between grace and mercy?
Well, I would say mercy comes by way of your endeavor. You do something in devotional service and you receive the mercy. You chant, you serve in different ways. And so mercy is coming, flowing in different ways, giving you enthusiasm, giving you support, giving you intelligence, and also giving you happiness. Grace means that you haven't done anything, there's no qualification, and all of a sudden you receive something. So sometimes we say grace is special mercy. And the example is, if a rich man wants to benedict someone, because he's rich and it's his money, he can do that. And you can't say, well, you can't give that money to that person. And that person says, what do you mean? It's my money and I choose to give it. They're not worthy. Oh, well, that doesn't matter. I want to give it anyway. That's grace. Yes, Cliff?
Thank you, Maharaj. Do you have any practical advice on dealing with anger as it arises from intolerance?
Anger, they say, anger is the younger brother of desire. That's the Bhagavad Gita. When desire is frustrated, anger arises. Anger also comes by way of contemplation, sense objects. When we contemplate sense objects, and we're frustrated and enjoy him, we also become angry. Or an angry element starts to arise. Anger can be, we say, thwarted by forgiveness. There's another individual involved and you want to become angry for whatever reason. Practice the principle of forgiveness. That's one way. Another way is to mitigate the effects of anger is become more and more detached from material activities. Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, in anger, lust is there. In greed, lust and anger is there. In illusion, lust, anger, and greed is there. In pride, lust, anger, greed, and illusion is there. In envy, you get them all. So, yeah. Envy is the worst quality of the living entity in this material world. And anger is also there in envy, like that. Anger could be with a cause and without a cause. So therefore, the acharyas also say that one should not try to stop anger, but use anger in the service of the Lord. And that is, become angry against those who offended devotees or criticized the Lord. Okay, we're at 2 o'clock, so I think it's time for lunch. Okay, thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Shikshastakam prayers ki jai.